Welcome to the November 14th Lake Mills School of Board of Education meeting. Our mission statement is preparing all of today's students for tomorrow's opportunities. Could we stand and do the pledge, please? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I'm going to call the meeting to order. Roll call, please.
Don Delaney.
Here.
Rachel Davies.
Here.
Robert DiImperio.
Here.
Donna Thomas.
Here.
Richard Mason.
Here.
Shelby Riggleman.
Here.
Verification of meeting notice.
Yes, the agenda was printed in the Leader, and it was posted at the Bank of Lake Mills, the Lake Mills Post Office, and the Lake Mills Public Library.
Good, thank you. Agenda revisions, we're going to be deleting action item A about Avions, and adding October Treasurer's Report. So with those two additions.
I move to approve the agenda as revised.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the agenda. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. Community input?
Sandy Whistler is here from CAPE.
Sandy, would you state your name for the record and address, please?
My name is Sandy Whistler. I live at 303 Moss Street here in Lake Mills, and I'm here on behalf of Citizen Advocates for Public Education tonight for a couple of different things. First of all, I'd like to invite all of you personally and anyone listening in the audience who is interested to a special event we're having tomorrow at Lake Mills Elementary School beginning at 8 o'clock. Guests are invited to walk into the school with our students. There's going to be a reception from 8 to about 8:45 in the Lake Mills Elementary School cafeteria, and after that time the people are invited to tour the elementary school or the middle school or the high school between 9 and 10 o'clock. So if you haven't yet had a chance to RSVP, that's just fine. We'd love to have you show up tomorrow morning and join us at this special event in celebration of American Education Week. My other reason for being here is that about 3.5 years ago, our local advocacy group formed here in Lake Mills. And when we formed, we were one of the first groups in the state that was actually trying to do some advocacy work for public education. Well, since that time, many, many groups have arisen around the state. And they're now part of a larger group called the Wisconsin Public Education Network. The network is an informal, nonpartisan alliance of parents, educators, school board members, administrators, school districts, and groups across our state. The Wisconsin Public Education Network is a project of the Wisconsin Alliance for Excellent Schools, also known as WAES. And WAES is a 501c4 nonprofit group. The work of the Wisconsin Public Education Network is supported by the voluntary contributions of partners around Wisconsin. Both WPEN and WAES are committed to the public schools that ensure every child at every school has equal opportunity to learn and succeed in the classroom and beyond. The two groups work together to share information, ideas, and actions that help everyone get better at state and local levels in meeting those goals. Our partners don't always agree on every issue or policy, but our common ground is always rooted in our deep commitment to the success of every student in every school. You might remember at a previous board meeting I came and invited you to attend a Public Education Network event, the Summer Summit, which took place in Wauwatosa in August. And that was a gathering of public education advocates from around the state. Well, tonight I'm here to ask you to consider supporting the Wisconsin Public Education Network with a monetary donation. There's urgent work to be done as the next biennial budget is debated and voted on in the state legislature in spring of 2017. In past budgets, as you well know, public education has suffered painful cuts, forcing schools to reduce programming, to compete for teachers, and to turn to referenda to maintain opportunities for students. The Wisconsin Public Education Network is working to make this next budget cycle different. Both the Public Education Network and WAIS are working to support local and statewide groups to advocate collaboratively for Wisconsin's public schools. It is our mission to energize Wisconsin communities to advocate for fully and fairly funded public schools. We're getting traction, and we've been recognized by state leaders such as Dr. Tony Evers, who referred to WPEN's work as the best hope for the future of Wisconsin public education. And in one of his State of the State addresses, he even mentioned our local group, CAPE, as one of those local advocacy groups that is making a difference. Your monetary donation would support this local level work that has statewide impact. I have an invoice for your consideration, and I'll give that to you right now. And you will see that the suggested donation was determined by combining a base contribution with a per pupil contribution of 25 cents per student. This same request is being made of all school districts across the state. In the past, it has been made to school districts, but without a definitely planned way of making it happen. Madison, Milwaukee, and Eau Claire are the three largest school districts that have already made donations, and there are nine other districts from around the state that have already contributed. So on behalf of CAPE and the Public Education Network and the Wisconsin Alliance for Excellent Schools, I appreciate you taking the time to consider this request and hope that you will become active in our cause. I'd be happy to answer any questions or attempt to answer any questions that you might have.
Any questions? Sandy, thank you.
You're welcome.
Consent agenda, minutes of October 10th, regular meeting, and minutes of October 24th, regular and executive special board meeting.
I'll move the board approve the minutes of October 10th, 2016 regular board meeting and the minutes of October 24th, 2016 regular and executive special board meeting.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the minutes of October 10th and October 24th regular and executive special session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay, that is passed. Proceedings of November 11th, Finance Committee. You have in front of you the proceedings that have been summarized. Have a chance to read those over.
I move the board approve the proceedings of the 11 November Finance Committee meeting.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the proceedings. Any questions, comments?
I assume that later on the agenda there will be an expansion of this discussion.
Dr. Thomas will make a presentation. Yes.
Great.
Okay, we can do that with a roll or with a. We've made the motion and second. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? All right, that's passed. Vouchers and invoices for October 2016.
I move the board accept the vouchers and invoices in the amount of $597,118.98 for the month of October 2016.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any comments on that? Roll call, please.
Don Delaney.
Aye.
Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Robert DiImperio.
Aye.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye. And it passes unanimously. Treasury's report for September 2016 and October.
I move the board accept the September and October 2016 treasurer's report.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the September and October treasurer's report. Comments, questions? Roll call, please, on that.
Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Robert DiImperio.
Aye.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Don Delaney.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye. And that passes unanimously. The administrator reports. Mrs. Thompson, you're up.
Good evening. I have three things to share with you tonight. We had our Veterans Day Assembly last Friday. Mrs. Dahl and the specialist all put that celebration together. We had over 20 honored guests that came to celebrate with us. And Mr. Kiefer put together a wonderful presentation about the Veterans Memorial that he has in downtown and how that all came to be. So it was a wonderful celebration of our country and the veterans that have served us. The second thing I want to share is about parent-teacher conferences. Last week, our doors were open for our parents to come in to meet with our teachers. We don't have our final counts in yet, but the first attempt at gathering that information, our count was very high. So I will be able to email that out to what the final numbers are. And then the final thing I wanted to share with you, I gave you a letter at your spot regarding our grading and reporting. This has been an ongoing adventure for us. The last year, we collected a lot of information from our parents and from our teachers about the best way to notify parents about the progress that their children are making. We had all of that information together. This summer, our teachers met to go through their hopes of how they wanted to deliver this information to the parents based on the parents' feedback that we received. What I was not did not think would be so difficult was the technical aspect of getting our report card into Skyward. So Mrs. Phillipson and I have been working tirelessly with Skyward. We've had meetings with them, some webinars to be able to work out all of the glitches. And just a couple weeks ago, we think we have it near completion. My hope was to bring that parent team back again to look through what this online report card would look like. And the timing, just because of how much effort it's taken to get into Skyward, has taken far longer than I had anticipated. So the letter that you see in front of you goes through, we'll be sending this out to parents, the two approaches that we're using to grading and reporting. We know that parents want timely information about their students' progress, so that will be coming in progress reports at the end of each of the units of study. The math profiles of progress at the end of each unit, the feedback from the parents were those are too cumbersome. We need to boil it down to be more specific about what our students are doing. So over the summer, our math team condensed those IPPs to make them more user-friendly for our parents. We also have the writing checklist, which the parents said those were easy to read and to understand, but they wanted writing samples so that they could go to the website to see what does a typical third grader look at this time of the year. So we have those samples that we've been collecting, and we're putting together a parent resource page on our website so parents can go to see those writing samples. And then reading progressions in third and fourth grade will be new this year, with information about where the reader is currently at, with a most of them also have a visual so that parents can easily see the work that their reader is doing, and they can see what's come before and after so they know what to work on at home. The online report card will focus on the lifelong learning skills, art, music, and phys ed, and a reading grade. Within the reading portion, parents will be able to see where their student is currently at, where they should be at this time of the year for that grade level, and then a couple of things that they can work out on at home for their child to help with those progress. So it's been a great adventure to be a part of. It just hasn't moved quite as quickly as I was hoping for, but we will be ready to launch our first electronic report card at the end of the month.
Questions?
Sounds really exciting.
It's been exciting.
Yeah. That's great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mrs. Bauer.
Good evening. A bunch of wonderful things going on at the middle school, but first I'd like to start with something, a wonderful opportunity that I had. I went to Boston the last week of October, the first week of November, and took a course by Otto Scharmer from MIT called Leading from the Emerging Future, where I met with global leaders about social change and how to make that happen. Very exciting. He feels that education is on the verge of disruptive change, which I think we've been feeling for a while, but he feels like it's on the edge. Unfortunately, most of the people involved in these types of conferences are not in education. So I felt very fortunate to be able to represent education in that space. So the school district helped support that venture for me, so thank you very much. You'll be hearing more from me on that. As soon as I got back from Boston, the day I got back, we did PBIS training. So the middle school and the high school are both working on that. So we had our group, our first training. We have our next training in early December. Also, to let you know, just in case you see it on TV, we've been partnering with a police department on how to get kids safely to and from school. So Officer A. Strike and Mrs. Brown made a video on how to use the new school crossing down at the main street by the BP down there. So that should be coming out shortly. We had parent-teacher conferences the other night. We did an open gym format. It was very successful. We had a lot of attendees. And I wanted to mention to you that for Veterans Day, our student council put together a Close for Veterans drive. We reached our goal, and so on November 22nd, we will be playing trench ball / battle ball, staff versus students. And finally, at the end of October, we had our service day. Last year we did one service day. This year we're planning on doing two. And I'd like to share with you just a quick video of some of the things we did that day.
And this was when, Jen?
This was October 20th.
Okay.
So our students made cookies for firefighters, they raked leaves for the neighborhood, they visited classrooms, they made Christmas and Thanksgiving cards for the elderly in the district, they went to Brook Gardens, they played a game called Free Rice where they played trivia, and every time they got a question right, a social studies question right, it contributed a piece of rice. Here we are working with the kids at the elementary school. I'll wait for the that's playing Free Rice. They did some pet rock painting. They cleaned up trash around the school building and throughout the city. They went to the Humane Association to learn how they could contribute there. They also made dog toys in the building for the Humane Association. They're making the dog toys there, working with students. And then I don't know if any of you had the opportunity to notice, but Mr. Klotz took a bunch of lemonade, free lemonade for the community down around the square downtown. So we had several opportunities from that for our spring, spring service day where we'll work with Main Street and other, there they are doing the lemonade. So we'll work with them to come up with activities for the spring because they said they could really use help planting bulbs and those kind of things in the spring. So I just wanted to share some of those activities with you.
Just something that I'd like to add to that. I think, if you recall, when I talked about the new research that's out about college, career, and life ready, one of the things that they're stressed is community service as really a precursor to really successful vocational placements. And, you know, so really doing this kind of community service so young. Last week I was able to meet with Dr. Brown from Madison College, and he talked about really beginning vocational training in early elementary school. So all of these things are kind of tying together, and, you know, I think we're really on the right track by tying this together.
Any questions for me? Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Vogel.
Hi. Well, high school has been a very, very busy place the last couple of weeks, to say the least. A couple of special thanks I want to give. First is to Miss Linda Heimstreet for her work with the musical, along with the staff and the students. And it was fantastic, as usual. And Linda puts a lot of time into that. And I wanted to give her some special thanks. Also to the community, Lake Mills community, for their support of our football team. If you've seen the pride signs, the LCAP pride signs, the round two game against Platteville, Lake Mills, I thought, had more people than Platteville did. I know we had to travel 2 hours, and we were right in their backyard. So it was a great run. And again, thank you to the community for their support on that. I also want to give a special thanks to Mr. Eric Whalen for organizing this past week on the same night of, or one of the nights of the parent teacher conferences. We hosted the Capitol Conference Honors Band festivities during the day and at night. And that's over 100 participants from the Capitol Conference for students. We had 10 to 12 students participate as well, and got a chance to sneak over there at night to watch them perform. It was pretty neat. Also want to give thanks to our NHS, National Honor Society, for organizing our Veterans Day program. We also recognized close to 20 honored guests and had a number of speeches and musical performances by our men's and women's choir. So again, thank you to our student body, NHS, for organizing that. I just want to give you a quick update. I think that kind of the timing is right on this. We do have a pretty strong Hispanic advisory board here, led by our one of our Spanish teachers, Ms. Sisson, who runs this group of students. A couple things that we're doing this week. We have the academic coordinator from METC coming to speak with our group to look at the application process and to look at the kind of processes for financial aid. And we also, another day, we're going to meet as a group and look at different ways to boost Latino and Hispanic morale in school and the community and celebrate their heritage as well. So some things we're doing, sometimes kind of behind the scenes, stuff that we don't see out in the public. So our staff continues to work on universal grading practices. Again, the idea of enhancing student feedback and consistent among departments. Just like middle school, we completed our first team PBIS training and another one to follow in December. And then for this week's staff meeting, we're going to start work on EduClimber, again, focusing on that utilizing data for to improve our instruction and improve student learning. So that rolls out this week, and that will be a process as well. But so definitely a very busy time. And again, thank you to my staff for, with everything going on, a lot of good things going on in the classroom, walking throughout the building. So that's all I have.
Any questions? Excellent musical.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Excellent. Good. Thank you. Mrs. Sivrud.
Good evening. I'm late to the party today.
Thank you.
You can keep it.
So a couple updates. What you're going to hear, I think I mentioned this academic career planning, or ACP stuff, is happening across the state, and it's changing like portfolio requirements for all schools starting with the next school year. So in December, before our next board meeting, we'll have a staff training with the state so that we can understand a little bit more about what's required of us as a district and what changes we're going to need to make. One of the changes is that the state is providing the software Career Cruising, which is kind of an inventory for students to learn about different careers and kind of take some profile testing to see what they're interested in starting in sixth grade and starting to develop some plans. Their portfolio will be started, I believe, in sixth grade. But like I said, we'll learn more as we go to the training. After December, we'll start a committee that needs to include stakeholders from the community. So we'll plan on starting that in January. So if you are talking to people and they are really interested in what we're doing for career or vocational education, please give me their names and we'll try to include them in the committee. What I handed out to you tonight is the draft brochure that the transition program, that we're working on the transition program. The parents that came to the planning committee got to see this draft brochure at our last parent meeting. That seems like forever ago, but I think it was 3 weeks ago. But this is what we're looking at right now for what is our mission, what are our goals, what are our objectives, what will we be focusing on with the 18 to 21 year old transition program. Still working on a name for the program if we want to do something besides 18 to 21 year old transition program. And things that we'd like to include in the brochure, why I say it's still in draft, is maybe a location of where we're going to keep house the program, which is probably not going to be the high school. It will probably be a site in the community because they'll be, it's about transitioning to the community, so therefore we'd like them to be in the community. You got an email from me about some data that's been released from the state. I'm not going to talk too much about the data tonight, but the school report cards are scheduled to be released November 17th, and at that point we can talk a little bit more about what the report cards mean at that point. And then the testing that's going on before our next board meeting, the access test for ELLs, will start in December. The window opens like December 6th, I think. So we will start that process just to see where they're at in their language acquisition. Any questions?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Mrs. Strike.
We'd like to start with having Steve Murphy, our athletic director, give a brief report.
I put some fall participation numbers together for you. As you can see, we have a grade-by-grade participation number for each athletic program that we offer in the fall. I have the numbers there, the number of athletes that started the season and how many finished the season as well. Our fall numbers compared to last year were down a little bit in a couple of the different programs. I think we were about five people less in football and five or six less in soccer as well, about three or four less in volleyball. But some of that's due to different class sizes and things like that. So in all, we had 153 student athletes participate in some sort of fall activity. One thing that's been brought to our attention this year is we do have a Lake Mills biking team that several students are active in, and we've been asked to recognize them. So we're in the process of adding them as a club sport similar to equestrian. So that will probably be involved next year. And those students will have the opportunity to earn an athletic letter and things like that and be recognized at our fall sports awards. So yeah, like Mr. Vogel said, the football team had a great run in the playoffs. The community support that, that Lake Mills showed, even at River Valley, was outstanding. But we forget the successes of some of our other teams. You know, the boys soccer team started out kind of slow and they had a very good season. Cross country had two all-conference runners. Our volleyball team finished second in the conference to the eventual state tournament team, Lakeside Lutheran. And who am I leaving out here? Say everybody.
Tennis.
Tennis. We had four girls qualify for sections in tennis as well. So another very good season. I think they finished second in the conference and second in the tournament. So pretty successful fall season. Any questions for me?
I do. Did they have an equestrian team this year?
Yes, we had three participants. And they kind of do their own thing on their own, and then they we find out through the grapevine how they do. The girls are pretty quiet about the ones that participate, but they do a good job, and they work hard, and they're well coached by Kim Turner. She does a nice job with them.
There's a state meet, too, isn't there, kind of in Madison or something?
Yeah. We didn't qualify this year.
Okay.
But we were close, I guess.
Okay. And they're recognized with your fall sports at the Fall Sports Maker?
Correct.
Is that going to be the same for the bicycle team?
That's what, well, the biking team, their main competitions are in the summer and the fall, and they kind of wrap things up in the fall, so we'll recognize them at the fall awards next year.
Okay. Anything else? Thank you.
Thank you.
Continue.
Okay, just a reminder, Sandy had already mentioned, but tomorrow we're going to be celebrating American Education Week, and that will be beginning at 8 o'clock at the elementary school. In your packet, you'll received the language for the paraeducator portion of OPEB. This is the last section to be created. Again, it parallels not only all the other language that's been created, but it mirrors language in the handbook as it had been. There are a few things that are a little bit different for the paraeducator OPEB, and that's highlighted in them, those materials for you. It's already time to talk about the next election. Our spring election will be April 4th, and Dr. Rick Mason's seat will be up for election at that time. We are beginning the notification process as described in the WASB guidelines. The notice will be published in the November 18th Lake Mills Leader, and candidates must file all documents between December 1st and January 3rd, 2017. And I'll do an update on that each of the next board meetings to stay on that process. It had come up, I think at the last month's meeting, a project that we've been working on, and one of the things that we really need to do is update our policies. There are several ways to do this. I think that the board has committed to this process by having a policy committee and gone kind of systematically through policies, but it is a massive document. There are many state, federal changes that need to be incorporated, and quite frankly, we're at the point where we really need to do a comprehensive reevaluation of all policies. So there are two different groups that do that. One of them is WASB. That's kind of a system that we've used informally in the past. It's a bank of policies, and we use Bob Butler as a consultant as we create new policies. But there's also another company called Neola, and this there was a folder about this in your packet. What's a little bit different about Neola is that it is an organization of retired superintendents from Wisconsin. There are five consultants in Wisconsin. What they do is they actually will come to Lake Mills and sit with me. They estimate that it will take about 25 hours of nonstop work to go through every single policy and update every single policy. They are able to bring our policies into compliance with state and federal guidelines, DPI updates, a really comprehensive updating of all of our policies. I can then share that with the policy committee, any decisions that would have to be made, and then we would bring all of that to the board for approval. It's a very systematic, organized approach. And then once that process is complete, they are committed to updating our policies. So if something new comes out in the state, they will contact us. They're proactive, provide us with the new policy language. And so once it's done, they really help us stay proactive and stay ahead of it. The other thing is they have a server where this is all housed. So all of our policies would be online and maintained by them. It wouldn't be, in this case, Megan typing keying every single policy and maintaining that on our website. So that's a service that they provide as well. Right now, it seems like about half the districts in the state use Neola and half use WSB. And so I think we were really impressed with the individualized service that Neola is proposing. So I'd really like for you to take a look at that, and then I will bring some more information to next month's meeting, and we can maybe talk about moving forward on that. So as you read that, if you have any questions, let me know. They've even gone so far as saying that if we contracted with them, who the superintendent is, that would support me, and it's someone very local, very, very familiar with kind of the culture of this part of the state. It's not a faraway person or someone who's, sitting in an office off somewhere. It's a recently practicing superintendent that would help us through this process. So please take a look at that. And I have one other update. Do you remember what that is? The what?
Board docs.
Oh, board docs. Okay. For about a year, there's been some talk around the board about going paperless. And the product that the majority of the boards throughout the state of Wisconsin who are trying to go paperless, the product that they use is called Board Docs. And so Megan and I had a presentation from that company as well. I had seen it once before. It is a really customized program for school districts. Kind of interesting aspect with it. It integrates with Neola. So not only would board members be able to get all of their information electronically, they would be linked immediately with all policies, all of our handbooks. Everything would be in a one-stop place. It's a pretty exciting venture, and I think we're ready for it. If someone is not comfortable going paperless, there is always the option of having our office create PDFs and provide those for board members. But I think it's time, as you see our mountains of paper here. I think it's time that we move forward, and I think that this is a really great product. So we'll be looking at moving forward with that as well.
Okay.
Any questions?
Yeah, I do have some. How about the policies?
Yes.
Okay, so you've chosen this Neola?
That's the recommendation that I'd be leaning towards, right?
Okay, and this thing that says executive summary, is this the recommendation of our policy committee?
No, this is my summary of the two different products that I've investigated.
Okay, and we've been for a long time with WASB, with their policies. And
we've never contracted with them, to my knowledge. We have used their model language, and when we've needed clarification, we've worked directly with Bob Butler to do that. There's another avenue to go with WSB where we would contract with them much in the same way as you do with Neola, and we would work with a consultant there. They do a comprehensive check of all of our policies, and they would generate a list of corrections that we should make, and then they would point us in the direction of the policy, their bank of policies. The difference is Neola would actually give us an associate to really work directly with us to do that.
I kind of thought we had Bob Butler and Nancy Dorman. I see one of these is from, we did have a contract, I thought, with these folks a while ago to write our policies.
I think we did. I think we had some agreement. The big difference between the two is that WASP will give you multiple policies, and then you choose whatever you feel is the best.
Yeah.
This one will give you one, and the other side effect of it, I think, benefit of it, is that they sit down with our superintendent, and it's kind of a learning experience to go through all the policies.
Mm-hmm. So they write the policy, right, Rick?
Pardon me?
You don't have to. The policy committee doesn't really have to do it anymore.
No, we wouldn't have to write it by hand anymore. You know, so
there would maybe be some choices to reflect local culture, local expectations, but that there would be choices at some point, and that would then go back to the policy committee, and then eventually here. So one of the things I asked, is this a boilerplate? So our policies look like every other district that you do in the state of Wisconsin? They said, absolutely not. That's why we go through every single one, and we reflect the policies that you already have in existence. We work those into a more standardized form.
Do they use WSB policies too? Because WSB puts out, like you say, these boilerplate policies for a point from which you to start.
Right, and they'll give you, like he said, you know, 8 different choices about policy, you know.
Did these, does Viola, do their boilerplate policies come from WSB?
No.
They start from scratch?
Well, there's certain things that are required by state statute and things that are all there. So there's going to be a lot of commonality. But they, I mean, to my knowledge, didn't just take WSB language.
Because we, as board members, I know we all get these policies every month or every few months, you know, and they'll be like, you need this policy and here's three
choices.
Possibilities, mm-hmm. Or whatever.
Right.
I think they're all online now, actually.
Yeah, they are. WSB has a
bank. And the
bank.
Cost is about same? Once is $3,100. Who are these 5 superintendents? One is Scott Brown. Mm-hmm. Who are the others?
Steve Lavelle is the person that we met with. Okay. I can tell you where the other ones are from, but I don't know their names right offhand.
And one is $1,500 and one is $3,100.
Okay, WSB is $1,500 just for the cursory look through to give you that list of the policies. As you can see in this packet, NEOLA has already done that for us at no cost. They've already done kind of a quick walk through ours with a list of recommendations that the policies that we should start on right away, even if we don't go with them. That's it within your packet. There is a cost to go through all the bylaws and the policies. That's the $8,500.
$8,500.
$8,500.
I thought it said
$3,100. That is the ongoing price.
For each year.
Once we're all done and we have it all established, then it's $3,100, and that is for all of the updates, 2 meetings per year with me, and also to house all of that electronically.
So the first year, they want $13,000 to do this.
Actually,
WSB wants $1,500 plus $100.
$190 an hour. Right.
Somewhere in between there.
Right. Actually, it would not be that much in the first year because we would be probably just going through that review. And then that second cost that you see, that $4,900, that would be to set it all up electronically. That's a one-time cost. So that would fall in whatever year we complete the process. My guess would be that would fall in the second year.
What, the $13,000?
No, the $4,900 to get it going electronically. I can't really see that happening before July 1st. Then the next, if we would choose to do this, that next cost that you see there, they would go through and then look at all of our rules and procedures, all of our handbooks, and make sure that all of our student handbooks, our staff handbook, and all of our rules and procedures that we follow in all the district, or throughout the district, that those are then aligned and cross-reference with the new policy numbers and all the policies. And we, to my knowledge, have not had that kind of review done here.
Have a strong client list.
They really do. It's really taken off, and I didn't know that much about them, but in as I've been attending all of these superintendent training sessions and all these kinds of things, I talk to everyone I can. And like I said, people are pretty much split, but I see a growing number of people moving to NEOLA because of the individualized attention that they seem to be giving.
Pam, how much do they charge then per year just to maintain that electronic database?
That's the electronic database is $650.
Per year. Mm-hmm. And what happens if we decide to cut our relationship with them? Where are our policies?
We would probably have to download hard copies, and then we would.
So they would allow us to do that. Yeah, obviously, they should. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then we would have to figure out some way to house those.
Okay.
The thing about having electronic publishing that we have never had in this district is that you can search it. I don't know if you've tried to search through our policies. You know, you kind of go through an index. This would allow for searching on keywords. This would, and public would have access to this. This would be linked right to our website, so the public would be able to refer to policy.
Would we still have a policy committee?
Yes, because I...
There's unique things that, and the people that are on the policy committee know that even though a policy might be recommended to you, mm-hmm. you look at it and you say, hey, that's not going to go here in Lake
exactly. Mills. That's that, knowing that culture.
That's the importance, I think, of keeping local involvement because every community is unique.
What they told me is that when these updates come out twice a year, the updates come out, and then our associate would come and meet with me or meet with me and the committee right away at that time to go through all of the updates and all of the things that are happening at that time. So,
and to every policy, there'd be the policy and then the rule and exhibits. Is that the three parts of the policy?
It is.
Is it?
And one of the things that we can talk about, too, is at what point there's policy around how to accept those procedures and exhibits as well. So that's one of the things.
Every policy that comes to us will have three parts,
mm-hmm.
and we'll have two readings or whatever we have, like we did, mm-hmm. and we'll keep our current policy committee.
And what they'd also recommend is that as we do sections, we have the first reading mm-hmm. of, you know, after it goes through policy committee, we have the first reading of each section, and then we do the second reading and acceptance of the whole new policy procedure at once. I think that you can see that it's kind of cumbersome to do these bits and pieces of the handbook like we're doing right now. We're kind of getting lost in what's, mm-hmm. you know, first reading and second reading. They have a process so that we would have a timeline for each chunk being done and then accept it all at once, and then it's done, and then it would be uploaded into the housing unit.
Unfortunately, things change. We just get policies written and we have to change it. So there's probably things, this revolving door going on all
well,
the
time. Well, you've seen that with the updates that we've tried to do since the beginning of the year. By the time we've even gone through policy committee, things have changed and we've retracted them. So it's a living document, absolutely.
Anything else?
When doing a cost comparison between the two mm-hmm. options that we have, if I understand it correctly, with WASB, we have an open-ended time and materials
it's an hourly
component,
rate.
As well as our own staff time to be able to integrate this information and to digitize it or download it or whatever we do. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything else? All right, Mr. Deeb.
All right, good evening. As you know, we've been working with Avians to try to mitigate some of our losses from last year and come up with ideas on how we can save costs and be more closer to break even on our food service. Unfortunately, the idea that we have been talking about with regards to food service employees has been deemed a material change by DPI, so it would require us to go back out to bid if we were going to try to do that. And unfortunately, in mid-year, that's just not an option for us to go forward with that. So that's something that will be at the end of the year here, we're going to have to go back out to bid in order to go through with that idea. And more of that as we go along the line. Late this afternoon, something else did come up that I can. If it goes through, I'll talk about it at a future date. But it's a positive step in the right direction, possibly, that was okayed by DPI, and I'll have more on that in the future. I can't discuss it this time, but I will in the future. So I'm pretty excited about that. Update on the transportation director search and RFP process. We have several applicants for the director position, as well as 3 to 4 companies that were interested in possibly presenting a bid for the service as well. The deadline for that's the 28th for both to have the applications in and obviously the bid in as well. And that's the date that we'd be opening those two to look at them as well. I did include in your packet your debt service schedule that you had requested and an explanation that I handed out at the beginning. It talks about our debt and where we're at. If you have any questions on any of that, you certainly can ask me either now or at a future date. It's pretty straightforward. It talks about when the debt's dropping off and how much it is and what was it for. I had actually Baird update our spreadsheets that they give us each year to actually say what each debt is. I thought that was a great idea considering, you know, we have different board members, we have different business manager. We, you know, it's nice to know what each one of those debts are. So it'll be listed like that in the future for us. So, next, our audit, talking about that by Baker Tilly. There's some holdup at the state level and some things with retirement and that's holding up them and us. So it's nothing that the district's done. It's just that the DPI is a little behind on some things. So I wouldn't expect our audit presentation till January or February. I would say, he said perhaps December, but it's already halfway through November and I haven't heard anything. So I'm assuming it's going to be January or February. Other than that, we're just in the business office continuing the process of moving into more of the technology that Skyward can do for us and looking at going more paperless within the district, which is one of the initiatives I think Pam talked about, doing things online instead of via paper. And I'm certainly excited about getting that going. We have several reports that are due to the state this month, as well as payroll reports due, Y staff, things like that are due to the state. And I think that is it.
Questions? I have a couple of questions.
Sure.
Going back to the food service question, we're required to go back to have an RFP. Mm-hmm. And is there a statutory requirement on the criteria for making a decision? Is it cost only? Or is it simply a blend looking at the service provision, looking at the cost, balancing all those things?
Yeah, in this state, there's not a provision that requires you to go with the lowest bid.
Correct.
So that's really, you would want to look at what's going to be best for your district. So,
okay.
And I think that's a good that, because some states don't have it that way. So I think it's a good that you can decide what works best for your district besides the lowest bid for the space shuttle, you know. So it's.
And the last time that we solicited proposals for this, how many respondents did we have?
That I can find out for you. I don't know.
Three.
I don't remember how many. You guys were here. I was not. So.
Three.
It took me a while to count those, Rachel.
Yeah,
sorry.
And I just want to say we're not required to go back to bid, but we want to go back to bid because we feel that there's a way that we could reduce our costs.
Okay. And we have with the current contract that we have, are we able to terminate that contract to be able to go back out for additional?
Yes, this is it's a 5-year rolling contract, and we just have to let them know 60, not more than 60 days before the end of the school year. So, and that's all that's required with the rolling contract to inform them of that. And I think we've had conversations with them, and they understand that that's the case and know that something has to be done to take a look at this situation. So,
okay. Thank you very much.
We're being very proactive with it. So, I'm happy.
Okay. Anything else? All right, Mr. Regelman.
Thank you. So from the high school, the student council recently ran a mock election where over a quarter of the school participated. Approaching our table, we'll be running a Santa social during our senior exhibitions in December, concurrently with a food drive, which we will oversee. As for the student body, I'm going to kind of echo what Mr. Vogel said. In addition to our Veterans Day ceremony, the musical came to a close after an excellent performance. More clubs around our school are branching out and doing their things, running and planning their own respective events. Also recently, our Capital Conference academic team participated in Waterloo in a competition. As for sports, I'm going to kind of echo what Mr. Murphy said. After an exciting fall sports season, the football team clinched the playoffs and won a game for the first time since the 80s. We went three rounds deep, which is a new Lake Mills record. But all across the board this season, the community support at all games was nothing short of incredible. From the games, home and away, to all the signs around town, to all the buses, the fan buses, the coach buses, it was all incredible. And just recently, boys and girls basketball practices have started along with wrestling. Thank you.
Thank you. Facilities report. If you recall, at the beginning of the year, we asked Mark Rofers to review the enrollment audit for the district. Where are we going, and how many students are we looking at down the line, and all of that. That report has finally been, not finally, has been completed, and there'll be a formal presentation to the at the December meeting. And the facilities committee, it will review that report on this Wednesday. So that's where we are with it. Okay, finance committee proceedings.
Yeah, a lot has already been said about topics that we talked about. We met on Friday, November 11th. I was unable to get there right at the beginning, but Aviance was there, and both of the ladies were there from the from that food service talking. And I think you know from our last meeting that we were hoping that we could alter the contract so that we could somehow make changes so that we could reduce our $69,000 loss that we had. And one of them involved our, we have more students eating lunch now than ever before, and but our costs are still pretty high. Our personnel costs plus our costs per meal are quite high yet, and they were very amiable to try to work out something with us. But then the DPI got involved with us and said that we couldn't make any changes. These would be material changes to the contract, and we couldn't do that. I never knew DPI was that involved in the food service, but apparently they are, and in contracts. So we're still looking at that, and the committee talked about perhaps getting, as we go into this rebidding and request for proposals the next time around, that we get a little more legal advice to help from our attorney, whether it be Bob Butler or Jim Rooley or whoever it is. Second thing we talked about, and we talked a little bit about this with the rest of the board, pretty well knows about this, and this is another one of those unintended negative consequences of Act 10, and that is the sick and personal leave issues that are still it still exists in the district. And so we talked a bit about them, and I know at the next meeting Andrew's going to talk more about that, and he's been collecting data. Actually, our change turned out to be kind of costly to us. So that'll be, you'll probably hear about that at the next board meeting. Let's see. Oh, we talked about the transportation, which Andrew said, and we've got people sending in requests for proposals. I think you said 3 to 5 have come in, and about 6 applications have been received if we would stay with a district transportation program. And then we also talked, I don't think he mentioned this, and this is something that's going to come up too. As usual, there's a new interpretation of the Federal Fair Standards Labor Act, which involves time and pay for time and a half, and people who work over 40 hours, whether they be salaried or whether they be hourly workers. And the administration is looking into that, but it'll have consequences for our district. And but who knows, it could be gone, as you know, by a stroke of a pen. So that might happen. That was it, just overtime rules. And then we need some more policies. The DPI is working on, we have to have another policy for unpaid meals charges, and we recommended that we refer that back to the policy committee.
Thanks.
I have one question regarding the salaried employee. Is there a standard for which employees are affected by that?
Yeah, I can elaborate a little bit on that. The law that's starting in December establishes a threshold, $47,000 that if a salaried employee is a salary less than that, that they're based on a 40-hour work week.
Okay.
And if anything goes beyond that, then they're entitled to time and a half based on their hourly pay off their salary. So if they're a 2080 employee, which is 40 hours a week, you would take their salary divided by the 40, and that'd be in time and a half off that. So okay. That's how that would work.
Okay, so it's an annual salary threshold.
Yes. So it's annual. Thank and you. It's a weekly threshold, too, so it's kind of, they get you yeah. both ways.
Of course.
So,
that's the salaried one spot.
And it does not apply to teachers.
No, it does not apply to teachers, just the 2080 employees, or so, you know, the 40-hour year-round employees.
So year-round employees. Yeah. That make less that are salaried and make less than $47,782.
Okay, thank you.
So it's a targeted list that we're aware of.
There's another one for the hourly workers too.
Yeah,
sure.
It's that work over 40 hours, and that's probably going to cause a few more issues than is the one of the salaried people, because some people have extra duties here that are set hourly employees that could throw them over the 40 hours.
Yeah, I can a little bit elaborate on that a little bit too. Basically, that side of it is, say you have a employee that's hourly, works 40 hours a week, and then we could assign them to a co-curricular job such as ticket taker or line judge or clock person. Those would count towards hours towards their work, so that would be overtime. That's the big change that also could be affecting us. So that's why you hope you can fill those positions with our salaried employees, our certified employees. But as we know, it's very difficult to fill those positions sometimes. And that's all has to be hashed out. We're going to be doing that yet. So.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else? All right, action items. We'll begin with B. Approval of employee handbook updates related to other post-employment benefits for custodians, secretaries, middle managers, and administrators.
So this was the language that I gave you last month, and it reflects the charts that you had approved. So I think we've talked about those several times, but if you have any questions, I can certainly answer those at this time.
I'll move the board accept the employee handbook updates related to OPEB for custodians, secretaries, middle managers, and administrators.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? Questions? You've seen it before. Roll call, please.
Don Delaney.
Aye.
Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Robert DiImperio.
Aye.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye. And that passes unanimously. Approval Lake Mills High School trip. First one is the varsity baseball team.
The baseball team would like to go to a tournament in Wisconsin Dells this spring, and it would really work out best to do an overnight in the Dells.
Motion, please.
I move the board approve the April 7th and 8th, 2017 LMHS baseball trip to the Wisconsin Dells. It is understood that the board will incur no cost and will accept no liability for any funds lost for any reason.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Questions? Roll call, please.
Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Robert DiImperio.
Aye.
Don Delaney.
Aye.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye. And that passed unanimously. Spanish club trip.
In the last few years, we have put the high school trips on a rotation basis so that you know, the history trip is not the same year as the trip to France and Germany, is not the same year as the Spanish. So it would be Spanish club's turn in 2018. And as you know, we'd like to have these big trips on approved at least a year ahead of time. So this is a really new trip for us. I think it's really exciting. It's to Peru, featuring Machu Picchu and the Amazon. And it's with a company that I actually got to travel with to Costa Rica called Interact. It's a company from Green Bay. I thought it was outstanding. And I think this would just be a really fantastic trip for our kids.
Motion, please.
I move the board approve the June 2018 Lake Mills High School Spanish Club trip to Peru. It is understood that the board will incur no cost and will accept no liability for any funds lost for any reason.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the Spanish trip. Questions, comments? Roll call, please.
Robert DiImperio.
Aye.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Don Delaney. Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye, and that passes unanimously. Approval of short-term borrowing.
I move the board approve. I hit the wrong one. Sorry about that. Basically, what this is that in speaking with the Bank of Lake Mills, this is their lawyer's interpretation of the law and with DPI. Year to year from now on, we will be approving a short-term borrowing resolution at the levy meeting each year. And then by statute, that's when we're supposed to be doing it. This is just catching us up. And hopefully putting to rest anything else to do with the borrowing resolution. So we just have to approve it through here and have a couple signatures, and hopefully we're done.
Good. Motion, please.
I move the board approve the following resolution. Be it resolved by the Lake Mills Area School District Board of Education that pursuant to the provision of Section 67.128A1 and 8A Wisconsin statutes, the Lake Mills Area School District Board of Education shall authorize a short-term line of credit not to exceed $1 million with the Bank of Lake Mills pursuant to the above law as per the provisions set up in the complete resolution document. The entire resolution will be part of the minutes of this meeting.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the resolution short-term borrowing. Comments, questions? Roll call, please.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Don Delaney.
Aye.
Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Robert DiImperio.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye, and that passes unanimously. Approval of paraeducator resignation.
This first resignation is for a playground supervisor, a very part-time position at the elementary school.
Motion, please.
I move the board approve the resignation of Ms. Tammy Hedgecock. Is that right? Say it again. Hey, Jack. And thank her for her service to the Lake Mills Area School District.
Second.
Second with Mrs. Dr. Nolan. Any questions, comments on that? Roll call, please.
Don Delaney.
Aye.
Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Robert DiImperio.
Aye.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye, that passes unanimously. Approval of co-curricular resignation.
This resignation is for next year for the 8th grade girls volleyball coach.
Motion, please.
I move the board approve the resignation of Ms. Kaylee Cottrell from her 2017-18 eighth grade girls volleyball coaching position, and thank her for her service to our student athletes.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the resignation. Any questions, comments on that? Roll call, please.
Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Robert DiImperio.
Aye.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Don Delaney.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye. That passes unanimously. Approval of paraeducator letter of assignments.
There are two of these this month. One of them is to fill that elementary playground position, and then the other is a special education paraeducator position at the elementary school.
Can we take these two together?
Sure. I move the board approve a part-time letter of assignment to Ms. Christy Beanie as a regular para educator at the elementary school, and a part-time letter of assignment to Ms. Carrie Legal as special education para educator at the elementary school.
Second. Great.
Second. And moved and seconded to approve the reassignment. Any questions or comments on those? All right, roll call, please.
Robert DiImperio.
Aye.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Don Delaney.
Aye.
Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye. That passes unanimously. Approval of co-curricular letter of assignment.
This is for the 6th grade boys basketball coaching position. We did not have any applicants, and so our athletic director, Coach Murphy, has stepped in and agreed to coach that this year.
Motion, please.
Move the board approve a letter of assignment to Mr. Steve Murphy for sixth grade boys basketball for the 2016-17.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve letter of assignment. Questions, comments on that? Thank you to Mr. Murphy. Roll call, please.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Don Delaney.
Aye.
Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Robert D'Imperio.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye. That passes unanimously. Approval of gifts.
There are two very gracious gifts this month. You'll see they're listed in the motion itself.
Motion, please.
I move the board accept the following generous gifts and thank the donors for their support of the students of the Lake Mills community. $800 from the Lake Mills Market LLC to cover the cost of the coach bus for the LCAT football team, and $700 from the Madison Area Music Association for a grant to our middle school to purchase music equipment.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the gifts. Questions, comments, thank yous. Roll call, please.
Donna Thomas.
Aye.
Don Delaney.
Aye.
Rachel Davies.
Aye.
Robert D'Imperio.
Aye.
Richard Mason.
Aye. And that passes unanimously. December board items. I have one thing to, I will be passing on evaluation of the superintendent in December board meeting. Either get that electronically or paper or both, probably both. And then I will need that back by the end of December. You're not aware of that, but. Mm-mm. You'll see.
Okay.
Some
things that I think that we would you like for me to put an item on so we can discuss that donation that Sandy Whistler talked about tonight?
That what donation?
The donation that Sandy Whistler brought up this evening.
Oh yeah.
Yes.
We have to talk about that.
Typically in December we set the summer school dates. We'll have the second reading of the para OPEB language, and that will be the end of the OPEB discussion for a little bit.
Great.
We will have a presentation from Mark Roffers. That's the enrollment audit. He'll be here to present that evening. There may be the need for a short executive session to talk about a retirement issue.
Anything else? Anybody think of anything else?
Could we talk sometime about where are we with our emergency alert system? Remember, that was going to be in October.
I can tell you.
Is it up and running?
It is up, and the final training is Friday afternoon at 1 o'clock, and we'll be ready to roll by the end of the week.
Okay, so then parents and things can, if there's an emergency, they'll all get the same call.
Absolutely. The documentation will flow out to all parents within the next week or so that they can set up and choose their method that they'd like to be notified by. Yep. We're all set.
Okay. Seeing nothing else, a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Second. All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. We are adjourned.